Since this pandemic began, we have been trying to capture the experiences of people working on the front lines of the battle against it. William Brangham spoke today with a young nurse who has been at the very center of this outbreak and struggling with his own role in it.
That's right. We have been hearing a lot of stories from doctors and nurses and administrators who are caring for the sickest patients in this epidemic. But honestly, one of the most striking things I've read so far has been what KP Mendoza wrote recently on Facebook. He's a 24-year-old ICU nurse in New York City. This is just a sample of what he wrote. "I thought I was prepared to see death. I had seen enough of it within my first year in the ICU. Yet in the last 2 weeks, I have seen more people die than most people see in their entire lives. Now, I am not so sure if death is something I am prepared to see anymore. Death is different now. Death could pick me." The writer of those words, KP Mendoza, is with me now. Thank you very much for talking with us.
Thank you for having me, William. I appreciate it.
Can you just, as I said, this dispatch that you wrote felt like just a sudden outpouring of what had been pent up for a long time. What was it that prompted you to write this in the first place?
Yeah, it was the end of a particularly difficult week. So it's been about a month and a half since I've only been seeing COVID patients in the ICU where I work. And that week had been difficult because I had had three patients, again, at that point, and I was just kind of really tired of not feeling competent enough to take care of three patients because the typical ICU ratio is two patients to one nurse. And so having three patients who are really sick just makes you feel like you're never giving enough adequate care. And I was like, no, let me just write down how I feel, and I don't want to forget how I feel in this moment. And that's kind of what prompted me to write all that.
We've heard a lot, obviously, about the shortages of protective gear for people like yourself. And you've said it's gotten so bad at times for you that you even considered writing a will, which is not something most 24-year-olds do. I mean, is it still like that?
It's funny. I was actually talking about that idea with my coworkers the other day, because after what I had written got out, I think a part of me also is kind of resigning myself to the fact that either I currently have it, have had it, or will have it. And then there's this innate fear that if I do get tested for it, for the antibodies, say, that if I test negative, will that fear resume or will that panic come back? And I think that's what bugs me. So it wavers. It wavers because some days I go in fearless and some days I come out like a coward. And it's a strange wavering between confidence and a fear for my life. That was one reason that I felt the need to write it. It was mostly for that. I didn't have the heart to tell my parents how I felt. You know, I don't want to tell them that I think about dying. The last thing I'd want to do is put them through that. So ultimately, I knew that they were going to see it, but to have to say that to them over the phone or over FaceTime I don't think I could do it.
You also wrote about your parents, about how you said when you were in college, you felt like you didn't have enough time to call them and check in with them. But now that you in the ICU, you start to see their faces metaphorically in some of the people you're caring for.
I think if they can be called a silver lining, I think one of the few silver linings in this pandemic is that for me, and hopefully, and I really hope for a lot of people, that we realize how important it is to reach out to the people we love. And I think that's the one, like I said, beautiful part of this is that it's going to make people feel connected. And that's what I hope for. And it's one that I think we should never forget. And I hope more than anything that it changes things, whether it be for healthcare or for racial equality or for better access to health, to primary care providers, or just I hope it makes the world better because of how much we suffered.
On this issue of healthcare workers like yourself being celebrated as heroes, you said many times in your piece that you don't feel like a hero, and you also said, "Don't mistake my career choice for me wanting to be a martyr. I have a future," you wrote, "that I want to live out. I want to grow to be an old man," basically.
Yeah. I'm not gonna lie, you know, we should want to grow old. We should want to live full, long lives, and hopefully ones that are full of opportunity and happiness. And I've seen so many people have said, oh, like A, you're a nurse, you should be used to death, or B, like you should be accustomed to putting your life on the line. And I'm like, that's not healthcare, you know? And I can only say I speak for myself, but ultimately I hope other healthcare workers agree with this, in that I signed up to do good work and to come to work and to help people. And I want to go home. I want to go home. I want to see a future ahead of myself, and I want to go back to work the next day, motivated to do good work.
As I'm sure you're aware, there's this ongoing debate in the country about, are the stay-at-home restrictions too much? Should we start to loosen them up? Should we get the economy going again? You have a perspective on this pandemic that's unique to almost anyone else in the country. From your perspective, what do you think of that debate?
I think the main thing that bothers me is I'm scared for the people who are going to die who didn't have to die. And I speak on this because as a nurse, I'm very lucky to have a job. Like, I don't want people to think that I'm not aware of this. I'm very fortunate because I get to have a job, and I will never say I understand, because I don't. I don't understand what it's like for struggling families who are living paycheck to paycheck, whose stimulus checks are barely enough to cover 3-4 days worth of food and other things that they might need to provide for. But I'm for us opening the economy in a way that's safe. If we could bring cameras in and we could show people what's happening, I don't think people would be as, you know, they wouldn't diminish it as a hoax. They wouldn't be so blatantly sweeping it over as nothing more than a flu. And I just wish that I had an answer. But all I can say is that from my perspective as a nurse, I just don't want to see any more people die.
All right, KP Mendoza, ICU nurse working in New York City, thank you very, very much for your time, and thank you for what you're doing.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
And you can read an open letter KP Mendoza wrote about his experience and what he hopes we keep in mind when this is all over on our website, pbs.org/newshour.